evening and welcome to the school committee meeting of March 8th, 2017. Before I get started, I'd like to remind everyone that this meeting is being broadcast live. It is also being recorded for use at another time. If you would like to speak this evening, please come up to the podium and state your name so everybody in the audience can hear you and everybody that might be watching the meeting can also hear you. All right, I'd ask you to please join me in a pledge of allegiance to the flag.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Also, I'd ask you to please join me in a moment of silence. Thank you. Okay, welcome everyone. I'm glad to see so many people here this evening. I'm going to do a couple of things, housekeeping things. In a previous meeting, an employee of the district's name was mentioned. And when you mention an employee, they have to be notified and have the right to be here. That was not done. So I deeply apologize to that gentleman. His name is Mr. Fleck. Hey Fleck, he's our assistant principal here at the school district, for doing that, because as the chair, it is my responsibility to make sure that that doesn't happen, and it did happen, so I deeply apologize for that. I'd entertain a motion to approve the minutes of February 15, 2017.
So moved. Second.
Discussion?
Yes. I'd like to have the, on page 6, the vote. It should be changed from vote to come out of executive session to we went into executive session.
Michelle, did you get that?
Yes, Dan wrote me earlier. So I made the note.
Second.
Motion to amend.
Second. As requested.
Mm-hmm. I have a second. Discussion? All those in favor of the amendment? Unanimous. I go back to entertaining a motion to approve the minutes as amended.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you very much.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
If I could indulge you, if we could just congratulate the boys' basketball team on an exciting win today.
The boys played in Brockton this evening at 5:30, and it brings them through the semifinals. So I believe Mr. Rogers thinks, and again, this is just a possibility, that they will be playing Saturday at a site to be determined. Right. But if you watch the athletic website, he'll be posting it, so you'll be able to see where the event's going to take place and who the opponents are going to be. They've had a great run this year and an awesome run last year, so it's good. Superintendent's report, Ruth?
Sure, I just have a couple of things this evening because our focus is really going to be on the budget. First of all, as we know, I very sadly accepted John Quealy's resignation. He's going to be leaving Whitman-Hanson to take on a similar position in the Walpole Public Schools. So we thank John for his service to Whitman-Hanson. He came to us as a school psychologist and is for over 3 years has been the administrator of special ed and pupil personnel services, being very creative in programming and really looking at what the needs are of our students. So he'll be sorely missed, but we are required to have an administrator of special education, and Pat Dillon is beginning to work on the search committee, so I asked him to report to you this evening.
So right now we are forming the committee. We're almost there. It's a combination of several stakeholders, administrators, teachers, parents, staff, et cetera. And we currently have 20 applicants. So once we finalize the search committee, we'll screen the applicants and set up a time frame to start to interview. The goal is to have to the superintendent by middle of April, 2 candidates for her to review and speak with the long-term goal of identifying somebody by the end of April.
Thank you, Pat.
Yeah.
And secondly, I've asked Christine to report on the 2017 budget this evening.
Okay.
Thanks.
I actually don't have a year-to-date budget reports or year-to-date revenue reports since we had them last time. But I understand there's been some questions about the school choice funding and funds that we receive. First off, in the operating expenses, which is right here in this operating budget, that expense is for the students that choice out of Whitman-Hanson. So if you remember last time we met, where I reported out that it went from 16 kids leaving Whitman-Hanson to choice out to other schools, it dropped down to 8, so that reduced the budget by about $50,000. Then on the other side, the students choicing in to Whitman-Hanson, which I believe is about 31, 32 right now?
40.
Oh, 40, okay. So that is that's held in a separate account, which we call a revolving account, which means it can revolve from one year into the next. And that's totally outside of this operating budget here. In FY16, we took in just over $185,000. In FY17, we anticipate taking in just about $260,000. So I know that there was questions regarding that we were currently paying 7 teachers out of that, which equates to just over $400,000. So there is, the funds are there. And the average teacher salary, we say, is $65,000, but those teachers were all new, so the average salary is about $56,000. So if anyone has any questions, I'd be surely happy to answer.
Anyone have any questions on the school choice piece of this? Because it was confusing last time, and thank you, Christine, for reporting out on this.
Right.
There was some...
I think the one piece that's important to bring out, too, is that the money is really used for program enhancement. And the program enhancement that this resulted in was going from the trimester system to the semester system, which required having more staffing. So that money can be used for a variety of program enhancements. It can only be used in the school where choice takes place. That's an annual vote. You could choose to have choice anywhere from kindergarten up through grade 12. But we felt there was some confusion that 7 positions were coming out of a much smaller amount of money, and that was inaccurate information. Thank you, Christine.
Sure.
Anyone else?
And we're done.
Any questions for the superintendent? Okay, McQuan School. We had a discussion at the last meeting about what we should do with McQuan School and how we would proceed forward with the McQuan School issue. I think Pat brought to the table the fact that somewhere or Christine are both reported in that if by closing McQuan School, we would save somewhere between $800,000 and $1 million, depending on certain logistics of getting down to crunching the numbers.
Rough estimates.
Yep.
Yeah, roughly. And there would be other incidentals. There also would be some build-out costs to upgrade the Indian Head for younger children. There would be some bathroom-type issues. Is there any? Ernie?
Ernie. There he is.
There would be some upgrade for
come on up.
You know, for changing some of the stuff that goes on at Indian Head. So that would also come into play. Ernie, is that a really big undertaking, or is it something we would have to bid out, or is it something we can do in-house?
It would depend, Bob. Where we're putting bathrooms over there, if we put preschool over there.
No, not preschool,
okay.
Kindergarten.
Kindergarten classrooms. In most kindergarten classrooms we have bathrooms over there. There are a few and far between bathrooms in the classrooms. So we'd have to add bathrooms in those classrooms if that's what we choose to do. So that would be something that you would probably put a spec together, just like we would do with the roof, and put it out to bid and find out what it's really gonna cost us to put bathrooms in those rooms over there.
Okay.
So if that's gonna be added, yes, it would go out to bid.
Okay. It's nothing we could do in-house?
No.
Okay. Well, you know, we're just trying to get a feel. The committee's trying to get a feel for what the cost would be for both.
That's part of the next step that we'd be doing, Bob, is putting that other pot together as far as the bathrooms, what those costs would be.
I know you're kind of waiting.
Turnaround time?
Looking at the roofs and what we've gone through, the planning process, the bidding process, It's not something that's going to be done right away. So you'd have to figure out what's underground, number one, what is under the slab over there, where you're going to discharge that sewerage, where's the water going to come from. So it's going to take some time to figure out how we're going to do that.
6 to 8 months, I would estimate.
Yeah, that's about right, yeah.
There's a time frame to it,
yeah.
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, so that would lead me to the next question. Pat, did you have? That would lead me to the next question, Ruth, and this is for you, and this is something the committee needs to know. And when we start talking about time frames,
yep.
I've had several different people ask, is this something that's doable this year? Do we have to wait a year? Could you?
Yeah, I can answer that. First of all, we have concerns about the budget gap. So if you know, doing something right away could be very helpful with the budget gap. How as we began to look at, well, what would it really take to shut a building down, to begin to make the transition? Pat did some preliminary work looking at just available spaces. Working with John Queeley on special education programs, it appeared that if you were going to really do cost savings, you would need to do it over a period of time, or your upfront cost to do it quickly could almost offset the savings that you were trying to make. So initially we thought, yeah, maybe you could do it now. As we looked at it, it really looks like it would be for the fall of 2018. Our thinking about this, which is still very preliminary, is that there would probably be savings that would happen along the way as you begin to start to take the building offline. We've looked at the idea of possibly moving the preschool out, but we've got to do a much more in-depth look at where those spaces would be and if we could do that, but that would be a start. Clearly, repairs to the building would be for safety, but you really wouldn't do major expenses. Right now, there's about $5 million worth of repairs on our capital matrix for the Maquon School. That would come off, and repairs would be much more incidental. So those are the things over a period from this point in time up until school opens a year from now that we begin to see that. Basically, what we'd also see is a much more efficient use of space. The problem right now with moving immediately would be that we're not going to realize the decrease in enrollment at the Hanson Middle School until one more year. We have about 130 kids going from fifth grade to sixth grade at the end of this school year. The year after that, it's 96 kids. So once you have 96 students going in, that's 40 fewer kids. You're going to need less space to be able to do it. One of the other things is when you move a fifth grade, which would be what we're really thinking would be the thing to do, there are a lot of decisions that need to be made. Would that still remain self-contained? Would that become departmental, like the rest of the middle school? And those are all discussions that would need to take place over a period of time. Do I think for, you know, a year from now, school year, that it's realistic? I do. You know, I brought with me this evening what we're looking at in terms of enrollment, and Chad did a nice job of looking at what the projections would be even for FY18 and has us down by 103 students, and that's just for next year. So I think a year from now, the actual space issues would actually work out. Right now, Pat looked into portables, and you found those to be quite costly. Maybe
yeah.
Just give a little insight on that.
Again, I mean, it's tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands, depending on whether or not you need to augment plumbing and you know, bathrooms and things like that, and how you attach it to the school, or if it's a separate. And we're talking with the age of the kids, that certainly it's going to be more costly because you're going to want them attached to the school. And to Dr. Whitner's point, and in talking with the leadership group, you know, we need some time to plan this appropriately. John mentioned the compliance issues or challenges, and making sure that as we do the transition, that we're addressing that. You know, there's some contractual stuff we need to consider. And you know, ideally, if we had this summer to do to actually plan it out, I concur with the superintendent. We could do it a year from September, but we would probably be putting ourselves in a bit of a bind if we tried to do it for this September.
And you know, maybe Ernie, you could even weigh in on this. He was involved when the school committee voted a number of years ago to return the Park Avenue School to the town of Whitman. That wasn't something where we just dumped it out and closed the doors. It was pretty involved. And we really, and all we had in that was storage at the time. So.
Correct. So Park Avenue, the process we went through, once we identified that we had no more use for that building, the communication with the town of Whitman, plus mothball in that building. We were originally draining the boilers, draining the sinks, getting the water out of there. Then we had to plywood up the exterior of the building to make sure it was secure. So it wasn't just like overnight that that happened. There was a pretty good process that we had to go through to shut it down. So.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Having heard all of this, and this was somewhat of the discussion previously, I think that it would probably also help the town of Hanson. If we're not going to see an instant savings in this coming budget, we're going to have to deal with that budget shortly, as you can see on the agenda. And if it's not something that's doable, I really think we need to take a vote from the committee to see which direction we're moving in, because as Ernie said, and I was involved with the Park Ave shutdown myself, if we give the town enough notice, they may be able to get a desirable tenant. They may be able to come up with a great use for the building, and it may be some savings, Ernie. This boarding up or closing down or draining boilers might not even have to happen. The town, if the town gets a little bit involved too, which I know the town of Hanson will. So consequently, I mean, it's the committee's pleasure to try and make this decision. Does anyone have any more questions about the closing of McQuan? It appears to be a doable thing, but it doesn't appear for this year. Kevin?
Sure. Do we have any sense of how the closing, if it's planned for fall of 18, would affect the budget for that year? Like, what would be the net impact? Would that... Do you have any sense of that?
Well, clearly there would be staffing decreases. There would definitely be some cost cutting there, mm-hmm. because you would have some things that are duplicated, some that aren't. Mm-hmm. Just what that would be, you know, we're still looking at in that. The other piece with that, just to add on to that, Kevin, would be the issue that if it does have a staffing impact, we, you know, given contractual obligations and things like that, you really need time to let people know these sort of things mm-hmm. could be happening, and also could they be assigned somewhere else in the district, and just what that would mean,
right.
because things are changing all the time. Mm-hmm. Definitely there'd be savings there. I also, both buildings are too big for their enrollments right now. So there's bound to be a savings as well, because SJ Services would only need to be cleaning six buildings as opposed to seven. You're going to have facility savings right off the top. I think McQuan is the most expensive building to operate, isn't it?
Yeah, utilities is about, between the trash and the heating and the electrical, is about $130,000.
Yeah, so we reported last time, initial estimate, the SJ savings would be $141,000. Maintenance facilities, $152,000. Insurance, it's about $50,000. Mm-hmm. So. That aggregate is about a little over 300,000 plus any staffing.
And there clearly will be some expenses to do this. You've right. got to move things. You've got to retrofit, as Ernie talked about, the smaller bathrooms for the children. And that all has to be taken into consideration as well.
If you look at what's going on, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Chris.
So I think this is a really, really tough decision, right? So personally, right, so I have a child in McQuan. I mm-hmm. have relatives that teach in the school. I know plenty of the teachers. So it would be very disruptive to do McQuan this year. I recognize that. I think it would be a lot of change, and I think it would be really, really in a very short period of time. So I agree with all that. My concern, though, is if we're going to face a significant budget shortfall and we have a potential choice of looking at doing this more quickly, and I get it's going to be difficult, but that's going to save potential teacher positions. If we got to that point, that's where I'd really want to pause and look at this at that time.
See, I'm not so sure you're going to save teacher positions if you do it.
So that's so I guess that would be the question.
That would
so
be
what
the first
what would
thing.
What
I
would
think
we the, save this
the
year?
The biggest problem that I see with it is that we really don't have quite enough space to do it right now.
Okay.
That's the biggest issue. We know that a year from now, with that declining enrollment hitting Hanson Middle School, all sorts of spaces will open up. But that doesn't happen for a year from now. That's the biggest concern, and if we have to scrunch everybody in, I get really concerned about the quality of what we're able to do. So that's really the issue, Chris. If we had the space to do it, I'd say let's, you know, bottom line is if that heating system failed tomorrow, we'd figure it out somehow. But I don't think that's the educationally sound thing to do. I think there are some savings along the way. As we begin to look forward to that, there's certain things we're just not going to do that we would have done in the past. I agree with you. It would be great to be able to say, okay, that's the answer. But I think it would be a very proactive thing as you look to the future when it's the school committee says, all right, we see we've got a declining enrollment. We also have an aging building with at least $5 million of repairs, and both of our schools, McQuan and Indian Head, are bigger than we need for the number of students that we have. So
do we have an actual number, or could we come up with an actual number as to what we would save in the fiscal budget for next year if we did close it? I know you said it's minimal, but do we have an actual number or not yet?
We have what Pat's been able to put together at this time.
Yeah, I mean, I can read the numbers again if you want me to.
Well, yeah, I mean, we have what we disseminated last week, but there are also other costs that we'd really need to look at if we were going to do that. One of the concerns, and I've asked John to weigh in on this, with just the whole issue of special education, and that's where we could end up actually having to spend more money if we don't do it right.
Yeah, my biggest concern is compliance. I mean, in Hanson, both McQuan, Indian Head, and Hanson Middle, we have a number of substantially separate programs for our kids. And these are programs that have multi-grades that feed into it. But we can't have kids of certain ages be with other kids of certain ages. We have a window of ages that we have to stay within. So if you consolidate buildings, you may be creating programs with age spans that are too large and now out of compliance. So if you're doing that, now you may even be talking about splitting programs and adding a teacher somewhere. So I think I'm sure there's cost savings in it, but there'll be some, that
it
might
could
be
some
up.
Expense that goes along with it.
Right.
But
we'd have to research it first. I don't know.
Yeah, I think there's some real research that needs to happen there. In addition to that, with these district-wide programs, they don't even have to be in Hanson. So it's really going to require that we look throughout the district and see where different programs need to be so we can remain in compliance.
The other piece that we haven't even talked about yet is the impact of van transportation.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to talk about a whole new set of routes. If preschool is going to be at Duval, it's a whole new set of routes for van transportation, and I don't know what the impact of that's going to be at this point.
And we have found when we do move special education programs, we've done that in the past, the more advance notice we give to families of students with special needs, the more smoothly it goes for them and for their children. And you have a hand up in the back there. Would you come up to the microphone, Julie? Thank you.
So at this point, we're talking that Duval might be this place that we put preschool, but I just wanted to address to doing it this year. A group of us, the faculty, met this morning because certainly we want to welcome anybody who wants to come our way with opening arms. However, when you look at the building through a preschooler's eyes, we were a little bit shocked about the things that we'll have to take care of as well. Certain stairs in certain places, the size of bathrooms that I really never paid attention to before when you're two years and 9 months. So there'll be other impacts that we just need time to be able to think about and make sure we're ready if we're going to be the ones to take the preschool.
Okay, thanks, Julie.
Fred?
The enrollment, the decrease, is it all coming right from kindergarten and first grade?
There you go.
On up? Or is it little pockets, so to speak, in the later years? You know, fourth grade loses more.
Chad, do you want to speak to enrollment? I mean, I did print these. You can certainly...
Yeah.
It'll give you this is the work that Chad did.
We looked at the enrollment, and if you look at the sheets of the enrollment that we handed out, I think there's some in the budget books as well. There are large changes in the enrollment. There's large changes in the enrollment in the lower levels from K to 3 and 4. The numbers of students in those grades are much smaller than they've ever been in the past, where they're averaging 75, 80, 90 kids, whereas before they used to be in the hundreds. So I think that's where you're going to see the bubble, not only now going from, going into the elementary, the higher levels of the elementary, the fourth and fifth, but now into the middle schools as well, where not only you're going to see Hanson Middle and Whitman Middle, their new sixth graders are going to be decreasing starting this year, and you're going to see them steadily going over the next, you know, 4 or 5 plus years. And we did the projections for next year for FY18, and we're estimating based on current enrollments around 103 kids of a decrease. And then if we take it one step further, you go into FY19 and kind of move the kids. It's a little difficult because you have less kids in the K and one where you're kind of estimating. But if you keep the estimates based on the average over the last 3 years, you're looking at probably another 100 to 110 kids for the fall of 18 overall for the district. So the numbers are getting smaller because the numbers in the higher levels are kind of dropping off, and then now all the lower level numbers are kind of moving through the system. So,
Dan? Fred?
Do we know if that's consistent with other towns?
It is consistent. Absolutely consistent with other towns. Gary Maestas is superintendent in Plymouth, and I've been at meetings with him. When he became superintendent, the enrollment in Plymouth Public Schools was 10,000. It is now 8,000. So it is happening across the board. The smallest school districts are having a really difficult time keeping going. And it's not just Massachusetts. It's across the board. Just came from the governing board that is national. And their school systems in like Western Connecticut, Vermont, that they're all consolidating because there just aren't enough students. So this is what's happening. It's attributed to low birth rate. This is what we heard way back when we were looking at the building project for Maquon and Indian Head. When we got the numbers, we argued with them. We said, they can't be right. And they said, this is exactly what's going to happen. And they gave us actually a little bit more than they were going to. And the truth of the matter is they were right on target with what was going to happen. We used to think for a class size or a grade level at Whitman-Hanson, I used to always think 300 to 325. Always thought that. And in Hanson, I'd always think about 150 kids per class. As you look at that, you can begin to see what's happened. Clearly, the decline has been bigger in Hanson than in Whitman. But there's a lot, you know, less multifamily housing and things like that.
Kind of like devil's advocate. I agree. We're not going to be able to get this done this year anyways to help us out with this budget, because I see it would probably lose anything we get with unforeseen issues. But for the logistics here of students for the kindergartens coming in a year or two, I know we can't do kindergarten now, you know, we're just too much in the hole, but if we ever did implement that in the next year or two, how many more students would be put into kindergarten that wouldn't be paying that tuition, that can't afford the tuition we have, that would now get
that if we went to full day?
If you went to full day, how many more students would
probably
be put in?
We'd be okay, because we've looked at this and most of our students now are in full day.
Okay.
I think we were very successful last year, not in getting it funded, but in convincing people it was a good thing for their children. So it would be one or two more classrooms. I don't think, given the declining, you know, what we're seeing, that it would have.
I think we should be looking at that as well.
We've been looking at the numbers. Pat, when you looked at the numbers, we were really looking at current classrooms, right?
Yeah, that would be my concern, because we don't always look for future.
Right, no, I think you have to consider the future, absolutely.
Anyone else?
I just have a random question.
Allie?
I just have a random question, just something I'm thinking about. I know a lot of other districts like East Bridgewater, I know we were talking earlier about the ages, like if we were to put some of the younger kids in the preschool into the elementary, something about not having the younger kids mixed with the older kids. Is there room at the high school that you could shift a grade up, put the eighth graders here, put the fifth graders in the middle school, and then have more room in the elementary school? Is that something that could be done?
We really haven't looked at that. There is not a lot of extra space here at the high school to be able to do that. Because we had Pilgrim Area Collaborative was here using some of our space a year ago, and by going to the semester system, we needed the classrooms and they had to leave. So I'm not sure that would be viable. I think we'd probably be better off with a 5 to 8 school in Hanson.
Anyone else? I think we need to continue this discussion, but it doesn't appear that this is something that's doable at all this year, so we're going to have to move on with it, but I guess, go ahead.
Well, one of the things is the committee voted for us to put forth a statement of interest for the McQuan School. That's due in April. I think in addition to that, if the committee believes that it is a reasonable decision to close the McQuan School for the fall of 18, we're going to need the time to be able to do that. So for us, I think as a leadership team, the sooner the committee makes a move on this, the sooner we can really get the answers that you want to know. What do we save? What does this really look like? So I think these are some decisions that are going to have to be made, if not this week, but sometime before statement of interest time. And I think the more opportunity we have as a leadership team to really get this up and running and figure out what it looks like, it's just going to be good for the school system.
Yeah. Robbie?
So I know the selectmen discussed it. They're meeting Tuesday night. Have you had a discussion with at least the town administrators? Has there been any formal discussions with the town?
No.
Everything's been informal. Because that's something that, I totally agree. We're not going to be able to do anything for next year. Do it for the following year. I don't know if we'll have the cost savings that we're projecting only because we're going to have to put money into it. Absolutely.
There'll be some savings we don't know.
Right, absolutely. But I think the sooner that we meet with the selectmen, FinCom, and the other interested parties to say, look, here's the direction we want to go, the better off we're going to be. Because the town is going to need to make a decision as to what they want to do with the building. Do they want to sell it? Do they want to rent it out? Do they want to knock it down right away?
Yeah. Ultimately, so the vote to turn it back to the town would come from the school committee.
Right.
But that's what would happen. I know Christine has been looking at the capital matrix with them, and that came up in that conversation.
Yeah, I was over there the other day with Todd Hassett and actually Mike McHugh, too. And, you know, as we spoke to earlier, we have close to $5 million in capital warrant articles. So that would definitely have to be borrowed. They don't have that money for us to complete those projects. So do we vote all those warrant articles and then decide that that you take a vote that we're going to give it back to the town in September of 18, or do we do that now so then we can move forward in making decisions about whether we're going to do an SOI again for McQuan, whether we're going to vote for warrant articles and give them time for us to have these discussions, right? Like Robbie.
Well, that's my point, is the sooner that we the sooner you have a formal conversation with the town saying, here's the direction we want to go, and the sooner that we take the vote, the better off it's going to be for everybody.
I agree. Yeah.
So. Well, Robbie, the last meeting that we went to the selectmen's meeting, this was brought up.
No, I know it was brought up. I just want to make sure that we're going along it the right way, make sure everybody's informed so that there's no problems.
I know that we had voted to possibly move forward with an SOI, and you've heard all the facts this evening. I mean, I'll wait. We have a meeting next week. If you want to kind of sit on it for 7 days, I don't think we have to jump in it this evening. Mm-hmm. If you want to take a vote this evening, I'll entertain a motion to do any of the above.
Personally, I wasn't really prepared to make this kind of vote tonight. I know we've talked about this. I would prefer to wait a week.
Get some more numbers.
That way, maybe I can get more information myself and so forth. I understand the McQuan has its problems. I understand the logistics of moving a grade levels around. I was involved in one where I taught before when they moved the sixth grade to the middle school, and that creates a whole sense of that takes a lot of time to get that done. It seems to me there's a lot that's been discussed tonight, and I just sort of have to, I think, absorb it. So,
French,
in my opinion.
Fred?
I would look at the town of Hanson as our partner, and I can't see the trouble in waiting a week or even, preferably only a week, but to try and open up a line of communication with them as well, so it's not a, hey, there you go. See if they have any other ideas and see if they think that this is a very practical solution to the issue. Because, as Ruth said, $5 million to put the place back in order.
Minimum.
Kevin?
Start.
Does the vote have to be let's close the school by fall of 18, or could the, Ruth, I mean, what sort of guidance would be okay with the leadership team?
I
would
mean,
you want
when
us
we
to,
did this before, the yeah. vote with Park Ave was to return it to the town.
Okay.
That was what the vote was. It was, we're going to return it to the town. You could say return it to the town with the intention of closing the school so that, you know, that sort of thing.
Okay. So it wouldn't do you any good for us to say, you know, to direct the school to prepare a proposal to close the school by then? You want us to actually make the decision.
Well, I think
saying.
If you're really going to eventually save money and
yeah.
do it, it's going to need to happen. The biggest concern I had was we did go to Hanson Capital, and, you know, we were showing them $5 million in repairs. The other piece is we've talked to them that we have to do an engineering study that's, what, 35, how much, Ernie, for the, about 35,000 for an engineering study just to get a sense of the HVAC system. I mean, I think we've been fortunate that everyone's been relatively safe there. And everything's grandfathered in, so nobody's out of compliance. But I don't think it's a building that we can continue to have taxpayers in Hanson throw money into, and also using district-wide money into as well, especially if we don't need the space.
This is a little bit different closure, though, than Park Ave was.
It's a lot. There are people in it.
Right.
Yeah.
Park Ave was,
yeah.
Park Ave was vacant. I
right.
mean, I think if the Kennedy Donovan Center was taking up some space in there.
No, it was a closet, basically. It had
yeah.
old computer equipment in it. And Ernie's folks, I guess you had an office in it, right, for
right.
facilities. That was it. It was a preschool for a long time before that. But that was about it. But you're right. There wasn't anyone in it. It still took a while to close it.
Right.
Yeah.
It wasn't an overnight.
Not at all.
Yeah.
No. But
so
I do think we do need direction, because it's a lot of work if we're going to do it. And I think we really, we live in communities where there's not a lot of extra money flowing around. And so I think we
mm-hmm.
do need to be mindful as to how tax dollars are spent.
Can we invite the selectmen and whomever from Hanson?
I think
so the
for your
next
meeting,
week,
I
yeah.
think so, and keep them in the conversation.
Well, exactly.
Yeah,
exactly.
Won't be news to them.
No, it's not, but then,
you know, and clearly there, as someone said, there could be tenants. The collaboratives, both Pilgrim and North River, are always looking for space.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't fix the building, but
right.
as long as you keep it open, things are grandfathered in.
I think the sooner that we let the town know what's going on, Robbie,
I agree.
That gives them preparation time.
That's why I want to invite the next meeting.
Everybody needs preparation time for this.
Yeah.
Fred?
I just want to reiterate, if we don't need the space, and the space can be moved into other buildings, as long as we're fairly confident that we're not going to see that population all of a sudden mushroom and have to build a school within the district, I mean, I would feel that it's just the right thing to do, would be to close the school and let the town do what they can with it, and perhaps they can make a revenue source out of it.
Yeah, I just think one more week to get, you know, have everybody get more time.
That's fine.
To get numbers.
Sure.
Because, you know, we don't want to make a vote and find out it actually hurts us.
No way.
No, I mean, I think you want to be partners. I think it's what
you're that's why, like Robbie said, I mean, we already went to the selectmen. They pretty much know, but this is a big deal because they're going
to
have to know what they got to do with that building.
Right.
We can always just, you know, give you 1 year notice to move them into the other schools. And
thanks.
Okay, so if the administration would keep on searching
yep.
and looking at
well,
what's
we'll
going
on. We'll be fine-tuning our numbers over the past week, the next week, you know, between now and then, we'll see what else we can come up with. We've really tried to look at all the considerations, and there are many when these sort of things happen.
Okay, everybody okay with that?
Great, thank you.
All right, we'll discuss it next week. Give you some time to think. Duval Roof and McQuan Roof updates.
Sure. Last Friday, we received five proposals for the Duval evaluation, the roof over there. And we have the top three is Gale Associates, Habib Associates, and CBI. The team consists of Ernie, myself, Julie McKillop, the principal at Duval School, and Lisa Green, the assistant town administrator in Whitman. We are interviewing all three of the candidates tomorrow between 10 and 2 p.m. And we'll bring that back to you after the interview happens, and we'll go from there.
The McQuan roof update is that the execution of the contract is in progress with Almar LLC. They actually have the contract. I expect to get that back in the next couple of days. I don't need signatures from Bob, Jim McGann, myself, and the town accountant over Hanson, and then we can proceed.
Okay.
Okay.
Questions, Mike?
Seeing that we may potentially be closing or tearing down McQuan, can you avoid that, put that on hold?
We can absolutely put it on hold. They have it right now, and they're signing it first. We absolutely could put it on hold.
I mean, you're spending, what is the amount, $70,000?
It's like just under $60,000.
Kind of crazy to put $60,000 into a roof if you're going to tear the building down.
I agree. But.
Well,
I know what they're doing.
Right.
No, I know.
But no, I agree with you.
Yeah.
But that, again, why we want the selectmen and people here.
Right.
So that
yeah.
they have input that. Into it exactly.
Well, we've got a week on that. I think we can turn that around, Mike.
Yep.
Really. Yeah. Good point. Good.
And they could use that money for something else because it was appropriated at last town meeting. So.
But it could be used. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It could be used for something else.
Right.
Okay. Thank you, Mike.
Okay. Anything else on either one of those roofs?
Nope. That's it.
Okay. Regional Agreement Committee. The committee is just about full. Amy Wright's going to be the person from the Finance Committee in Hanson. So I think that leaves us with one opening.
Yep, Whitman Board of Select.
Whitman Board of Select.
Yep.
And I think
we can announce Jim Egan because we didn't talk about Jim or Mike Michello.
Yes. So we have one committee left, and they'll be filling that probably this week. So that'll take care of that. Then we have to contact the three people that are coming from the other committee.
Right.
And get some dates started and get started on that so we can update this regional agreement. Okay, any questions? FY 2018 budget discussion. Christine?
Okay. I'm gonna start with the health insurance. The steering committee met last Thursday afternoon and they've recommended to the member towns, which they will vote on March 23rd, that the Blue Cross Blue Shield and Harvard Pilgrim HMO traditional legacy plans are going to increase by 16%, and the rate saver plans are going to increase by 11.5%, and their benchmark plan, which we don't currently offer, is going to increase by 7.5%. Typically, the increases have always been what they call a blended rate, but this year they're actually separating it out. So anyone on Blue Cross Blue Shield or Harvard Pilgrim Healthcare in the traditional legacy will be increased by 16%, rate saver by 11.5%, and benchmark, which we currently don't offer, 7.5%. And as of the last invoice that we received from Mayfair Municipal Health Group, well, there's also going to be a 5% increase in the dental insurance, which there hasn't been an increase in the dental insurance since 2012. 5%. Currently, right now, our participation of the employees here is 89% of our participation in the health insurance is in what we call the HMO or the traditional or legacy plan. So, as you recall, I had estimated a 10% because that's what we were being told, that because typically they would blend the rate, but they're not doing that this year. And the member towns still need to vote March 23rd, but that is going to increase the level service budget by just over $245,000. The other adjustment that I made to the budget is on the positive is, again, I talked to David. We talked to David Leary today. Ruth and I had a discussion with him about the finances, and he believes that we can increase what we expect to get in revenue from our interest-bearing accounts to $18,000. So taking those two things into consideration, now the anticipated deficit is $2,154,779, which is level service, that would be 11.5% assessment increase.
Okay, so if you voted 11.5% increase, which would be $2,147,260. The increase to the town of Whitman would be $1,278,693, and the increase to the town of Hanson would be $868,567. If you take your budget book and go to page 34, that's where I'm getting these figures. The left-hand column.
37 is larger.
11.5.
It's in section 4.
No. Everybody there? See it?
Mm-hmm.
Discussion? Tonight, I would like to see us set some sort of an assessment. I want to remind everyone, once the assessment is set, you cannot reset it at a higher rate next week. Next week is the drop-dead date that it has to be set for the 45-day period. So just for instance, if you set an assessment at 6% and you determine next week, oh, something else has happened, as you've just seen, $245,000 increase in insurance and an $18,000
positive
move. It didn't change a lot other than it just went up $233,000 from where we were last week. So consequently, that's an obvious increase. So having said that, again, if you vote, I'm just throwing numbers out, I'm not suggesting where you set this assessment. You can't go up, you can only go back once it's set. And if tonight you vote an assessment, it can only decrease as we move forward with this. Discussions about this budget from the committee?
I just have a question.
Allie?
The current assessment that the towns are paying, isn't it like 3%?
A 3%?
Isn't that what they currently funded
last year?
Was it
yes.
Three?
Yes, three.
That's what I call
right.
It.
Yes. In the last few years, I think it's run three. It's averaged out about
we
that.
We had a 6 1 year. We had a small override, and we were able to make that work.
Right.
Yep.
But as you can see, to get level service, just exactly what we have now, and to just reiterate that, level service is not adding anything. Mm-hmm. It's exactly what we have now. You would need 11.5 from the towns. And that would still leave you about $7,000 short. Fred?
Christine,
yes.
Any chance of any more surprises as far as...
No,
this
is what the steering committee voted to bring to the member towns, which we will vote on March 23rd.
And so that's not going up, per se?
No.
Okay.
Nope. But typically, they've done what they did, a blended rate, and this year they're not. They're breaking it out by plan. And we currently have 89% of our participants in
and
the HMO plan.
The benchmark plan? Is that basic lifeline?
Yeah, that we're going to have that option. We have open enrollment from May 1st until the end of May, and we're actually having a health and benefits fair April 27th. So we're anticipating we're going to be able to offer that lower plan.
Okay. So we may see a couple of shekels, but...
Right. We'll see.
I know myself, I can't see us going backwards. I just can't see it. I don't know what it's going to take, if it takes, you know, having a motion. I'll make the motion for an 11.5% assessment. And then trying to figure out what the towns can afford, what can have to go on an override basis, and what our contingency plan is, God forbid, but I can't see us in good conscience, or at least myself, I should say, in good conscience, looking out and not voting for at least a level service, knowing we do more with less. And everything is to the bone. I don't know if you can...
Well, what I'd just like to add is the numbers that we put together in your budget book were from the most recent DESE information, which at that time was FY15. Just recently, FY16 numbers have come out, and we have slipped from 11th from the bottom to now 7th from the bottom. So we are closer to the bottom for FY16 for last year than we were before. So you talk about slipping back, it'll happen.
Fred, are you making that, were you making that motion?
Yes, I'll make that motion. I'm just concerned that it's not enough.
I'll second that motion at 11.5, because we can't go backwards. We fought too hard to get what we got last year back. We can't go backwards and start losing everything again.
Kev?
Can I just, but we did go backwards last year. I mean, we got zeroed back to 3%. I think you have to judge this based on the results and how close you actually get to moving the number forward. I mean, if you assess too much, if you assess to the point where there's no chance absent a tax increase, you're going to run the risk that you don't get it at all. And, you know, I think it's, you can't just wash your hands and say, well, you know, we tried and then we didn't get it. I think when we set a number, I think we should consider where the money might come from and how to get there. Keep in mind that with the population shift this year, Hanson could afford more than 3 without much struggling there. I mean, you could go higher because you might be able to operate at a higher floor than normal. Because, I mean, we've seen what happens when you try for the override, you don't get it. It's going to be 3. I mean, that's what it's always been. But you might be operating at a higher floor. And I think when times get tough, you start thinking about what are we spending money on and should we change our priorities? I mean, that's something town meeting could consider. I look at the busing numbers, for example, and see that every single year Whitman's spending almost $400,000 on buses. Your condition of schools eventually gets to the point where it doesn't make sense to spend money on buses that are taking kids to schools that don't have teachers in them. And so if you can factor that large chunk of money into the assessment and say, you could afford, and I'm just, I have to work the numbers out more specifically, but if you're in the range of somewhere 5 to 6% with the suggestion, I mean, that's a question for town meeting, but the suggestion would be town meeting can actually come up with that money on the Whitman side from busing and on the Hanson side with a normal 3% assessment to them. And I think if, especially in light of the fact that you're looking at closing a school next year, and if you wanted to push for an override next year, we've seen the gap. The gap's $1 million, $1.5 million. We're always chasing after that. If you can take the first $500,000 or so out of just savings from closing a school, then your override number to actually push forward on the budget you were looking for last year, you get a lot closer without going for a level service this year, which would entail an override. And then there's going to be another shortfall next year. If all we do is get to level service, we're going to be back here again next year. So those are just thoughts. I'm not putting a number forward at the moment.
I've said this many times before. If we vote for the 11.5%, I say we stay with the 11.5%. I've been on this committee for a few years, and it seems like we always come up with a number, and then we listen to the town side, and I understand their dilemmas, and we acquiesce. I don't think we can acquiesce anymore. I think we have to push ahead, see what people are feeling. In other words, do they want to support their schools? What's the priority in the town? And I think our role as school committee members is to do what's right for the students of Whitman and Hanson. Our job is to create a budget that we think is sound enough to continue the education for the students of Whitman and Hanson. And I think our job is to be as realistic as possible in hoping that the town sees it the way that we look at it, because that's our charge. Our charge is to create our own budget. It's not the selectmen of either town or the town manager of either town to tell us what our budget should be, nor the finance committee. I respect all those positions, but our job is to run a school, to run it properly, and if 11.5 is what the committee wants to set, then I say stay at 11.5% and bring it to town meeting at that.
Allie?
Well, I agree. I mean, we set a budget every year. You know, we say this is what we need to ask for, and then every year
the town comes in and they say, oh, no, we can only do 3%. That's all we can afford. You know, I go to the town meetings, obviously, for Whitman, and as residents, we make sure that we fund everything that the town needs. Well, it's high time that the town fund the school for what we need. This is our children that we're talking about. They need to step up and fund it, find the money somehow and do it. We're not going to get any more money from the state. We know that it's a fact. These towns need to step up and fund us where they need to. And right now, they're just not. We can't, if we're going to set it at 11.5, we can't back down, as you were saying. We need to stick with it.
Yeah.
They do. They come in every year and they go, oh, no, we can only afford 3%. And then we go, oh, well, okay, well, we'll take it. We can't do that.
Dan?
Yeah, the town's had since 2008, when the state took away the biggest chunk of Chapter 7 money out of the district. They've had since 2008 to try to backfill that, and they haven't done it. And all the school's done is cut, 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 cut. Now we have things like we don't have language arts and a lot of other things, and we just can't keep cutting out teacher positions and things like that. We're here to, like Ali said, and Bob's pointed out, we're here to educate. You know, if the towns can't step up, we can't keep backing down. A couple of years ago, we went 4 or 5. We backed down because they cried poor. We can't do that anymore because I don't think there's been any effort to actually increase it for us.
Mm-hmm. Fred?
Mr. Trotter, as in sixth grade, I agree with almost everything that you just said. However, I am cognizant that the towns only have so much levy room in their tax base, and there's only so much new growth. Those are the simple facts of Proposition 2.5. It's up to our communities at the same time to decide and come out and support this budget. Be honest with you, I'm ashamed that I'm talking at 11.5%. Because as Dan just said, languages, talented and gifted, a reading specialist, a math specialist, there's so much that we don't have that it's sickening and it's wrong. But just to want to stay where we are right now should be a no-brainer. And I don't know if I could live with myself driving down the street, seeing a kid walking home from school, voting for 5 or 6 or 7%. You know, looking them in the eye. I couldn't. I feel I need to make the best faith effort possible. That's where I'm at in my head.
Well, is everybody... At this particular juncture, Fred, I agree a lot of with what everyone has said. If you step away from the 11.5%, it's kicking the can down the road, and next year you're going to have a bigger deficit. Mm-hmm. There has to be a point, because what's happening in the true hard scheme, grand scheme of things from a business point of view is our costs and our revenues have giant gaps in them. We have contractual agreements that are in place that we have to deal with. We have insurances that we have no control over, and it keeps going up. If you look at area towns, and I have the chart, and just so people will see, you have on the higher scale, Hanover's the highest in the local area. Plimpton's next, Kingston's next, Abington's next, East Bridgewater's next, then Halifax, then Pembroke, and we're going down the scale, ladies and gentlemen. Then West Bridgewater, then Rockland, then Raynham, then Hanson, then Whitman, the tax charts. Whitman and Hanson have been getting, for lack of a term that everybody will understand, a deal for 20 or 30 years. Regionalization was a wonderful thing. But it appears, as you can see, the state's weaning us off of the regionalization and lowering what they're sending us every year and forcing the town's hand, forcing the towns to pay. But the towns have been getting a very, very good deal for many, many years. But as everyone knows, it ends at some point, and it has ended. This committee has to make some sort of a decision and see what the towns will fund, because we have every year been doing what Mr. Trotter has said and what Mr. Young has, I mean, what Mr. Small has said. We've been falling back. And we've been coming back to 3%. And the problem is it just pushes it down the road. The gap gets larger and larger and larger until we are where we are. And to paraphrase someone God rest his soul, John McEwen said long ago, we were cutting bone, and we're past that now. we're way past it. So I think it is incumbent upon this committee to set some sort of an assessment and let the people of the towns decide what type of school district they want to have in the towns of Whitman and Hanson. I don't see any other choice. If I saw where we are going, or if anyone has any other ideas, but closing McQuan this year is not going to help us. And truthfully, if we close McQuan next year, it's only going to close up the gap of what the increase is going to be anyway.
That's right.
So truthfully, it is a savings, but it's only going to shut some of that gap down of next year's increase.
I don't think I'm happy, or you know, the committee's probably not happy with a level service budget. In the Globe last Sunday, there was a piece on innovative schools, and there were some schools in this area that were mentioned. And I think we need to move forward, and I think we would should be, or I'd like to see us being one of those, quote, innovative schools. But we're never going to be an innovative school if we do not increase the budget at least this year, and then hopefully it will continue to move up a little bit in the following years. But as I said before, if this is the assessment number we choose to, personally, I'm going to stay with that number, and I hope everyone else stays with that number until town meeting.
Anyone else?
So, Paul, I have a question. Just
yes, Chris.
As one of the new members. So, agree with the sentiment, so I'm not going to rehash them. But as it pertains to something like full-day kindergarten, so if we did stick at the 11.5%, and we did want to look at that, is that a viable option, or do we need to factor that into our 11.5%?
Full-day kindergarten's about a $400,000 to $450,000 expense. It's certainly not built into this budget right now.
That it'd be
talking 15%.
It's 13.5 if you had 400,000. Because every 1% is about 186,000,
right.
So it's
yep.
It's a couple percent more if you go to that. Just going by the chart, and I'm just rounding the figures. I also want everyone to realize that this committee voted last week to take $750,000 out of E&D. So, I mean, if you added it in, the gap is really $2.9 million when we started out. Mm-hmm. I mean, with the increase that Christine just gave us this evening, the gap was $2,154,779. Add $750 to that, it's $2.9 million.
Right.
So, I mean, the gap is fairly large, and a lot of these things are stuff that you can't control. Anyone else? I think I've
just,
said enough.
Just a quickie. And Kevin, with yeah. the transportation, I agree. But that's, you know, town floor should make that decision whether they want to have their kids being bused. Or they're going to have to start paying a fee or something.
We can't make that. That's a town
right.
decision.
That's a town decision.
It is. We took it to the town before, and they didn't want to do it.
You know, because I agree if we can get rid of another $400 off
there's
on the
your full day cake.
Yeah.
There you go.
Exactly.
Yeah. Just like, you know, I go pick up my kid, and I see a lot of people picking up their kids, and the buses are.
I know.
It's like you have
more pickups than you do. We are mandated to transport 2 miles and beyond, and we're reimbursed for 1.5 miles beyond. Non-mandated is picked up by the town. That doesn't, non-mandated means you don't have to do it.
Yeah.
Right.
That's something we should bring up.
And you could charge for it. They will allow you to charge for non-mandated busing.
And mandated is not fully funded.
No.
And no. Hopefully we will get a little more revenue there.
Now, another thing to take into consideration that was discussed when both of our state reps and our state Senator Brady were here is there is a proposal on the table of they're back to $20 per pupil. If that stands, it's going to cost this district $137,000 more. So to answer your question, Fred, is there more on the horizon? We don't know that. I think Representatives Cutler and Deal and State Senator Brady put forward something to make it a law to fund that at $50 or $55,
yeah.
But none of that's happened yet. You know, they're doing their best to get all of their colleagues, but that is another hidden expense that could inevitably come forward before this budget is done, because we have 7 days to set an assessment.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the drop-dead date.
Yeah, but
7 days from now.
You're not going to know any of that information.
Until after the
June.
June is usually the earliest, so that's why, you know, we were able to do something with the libraries, was because of the $55 per student.
And that's,
if no one from the committee has anything else to discuss, I would be more than happy to open it up to anyone in the gallery. Come right up.
Come on up.
Hey, folks.
You're not wearing shorts?
George Farrow, I live on Harvard Street, and principal of Whitman Middle. I think this is my 15th spring that we've talked about budget. I think before I got the job, I think I was already hired, baby, so I came to some of these at the old high school. I applaud the conversation tonight, but I just think that everybody needs to know that whatever you vote on, if you vote on the percentage that Mr. Small says, or whatever you vote on, that's, if you were to vote an 11.5 or whatever it is, and that was to stay, that would still keep only 50 students to 60 students eligible for Spanish in the middle school. That would still keep upwards of 34 to 36 in my related arts. So, you know, I'm conflicted. When we're talking money, we're talking towns, we're talking everything else. I try to be a good citizen and everything. But what you're talking about is just to get where we are today. And today is difficult. When I look at, I'd like to offer Spanish to way more kids, a lot more kids, and I can't do that. I'd like to have different various things. So what we're talking about in this day and age is trying to just keep there. And there is pretty high. So I, you know, or pretty low in foreign language. So I just wanted to try to bring that to the everyday realistic thing of what's taking place. Thank you, and I applaud what you're doing.
And I know you're the president of the Principals Association.
Yes, sir.
So you could probably, hopefully, share this. How many other middle schools, forget about not being able to offer a full one language.
Sure.
Offer two or three languages.
Most schools on the South Shore, never mind across the state of Massachusetts.
So they offer French, Latin?
Most schools offer at least French, Latin, Chinese, and Spanish. Yeah, a lot of them do. And but I don't even bring up these conversations, I gotta be honest with you, because we're talking about things on a different level. But when we go to the South Shore principal meetings, for the middle school level, we suffer from a deficit of helping our higher students and then helping our most needy students also. And I think what sometimes we forget is that we do well on both ends, because smart kids can learn. They don't need me, they don't need you, they don't need any teacher in the world. They're smart. Some of our neediest students can learn because we have special ed programs and laws and things in place. But it's those, hey, I need somebody to make sure that I go from a C+ because I'm a seventh grade boy, and if my mother doesn't bust my chops, I'm just going to do that. And we need to make sure that we have things that the average student who can excel, we can catch, we can help, we can remediate, as well as providing foreign language to most students at this day and age.
Just to speak to this point of not having the adequate funding, the most recent numbers from the state put the average per pupil at over $15,000 per pupil. Multiply that by our 4,000 students, and that gives you a sense of what other school districts in Massachusetts are operating under for budgets, $60 million budget. If we had a budget like that, it would be a far different story that Mr. Farrow would be telling you this evening. And he is working with colleagues who are principals of schools exactly like that, and they're right around here. Yeah.
I just want to let you know, but I appreciate the discussion today, and I appreciate the fact of where it's going. Thank you.
Thank you, George.
Thank you, George. Just before, again, I invited everybody, but I'd like to read you some other stats. This is the Whitman-Hanson Regional School District versus the state average expenditure. And you hear all kinds of different stuff about top heaviness. Well, our administration per pupil cost is $294 per pupil. The state average is $531,000. I mean, $531. The instructional leadership cost is $646. The state average is $975. Again, were a third under the average. The classroom and specialized teaching is $4,680 per pupil. The state average is $5,619, so we're 900 and change below it. The other teaching services, our other teaching services are $619 per pupil. The state average is $1,176. And I'm only going to read you a few more. As you can see, we're under state average on everything. That's why we're seventh from the bottom. If you look at instructional material and equipment and tech services, it's one thing that we're over the state average. The state average is 431.24, and we're at 683.90.
But we need to clarify that. Christine? Right.
The reason being is because we have the copy center right here in our building. So we're not leasing copy machines.
And putting it in a different line.
And putting it in a different line.
Right.
Yeah. So the lease looks like it's higher.
Right.
Yeah.
Because we're not leasing the copiers. We have a contract right here. Ruth and I just had this discussion this afternoon.
And that was for cost savings that we did the copies.
So, okay, we're better on that. Guidance and counseling and testing. We're at $338. The state's at $441. Pupil services. We're at $1,040. The state's at $1,429. Operations and maintenance, we're at $1,031. The state's at $1,139. In insurance and retirement programs, we're at $1,782. And the state's at $2,489. I'm not telling you this to impress you that we're doing a fabulous job. I'm telling it to impress upon you. What's going on here and what's going on in the average state level is much different. And that's why we're seventh from the bottom. That's the issue. It's why we're where we're at. And it is probably time to again, I hate to be redundant, see what the voters vote and see what they want to have for a school district. Because we have nowhere to go with this budget. Now I will open it up to the gallery. I thought that was an important factor.
Leela Donovan, 81 Old Mansion Lane in Whitman. Basically, any notes that I had that I wanted to say tonight are out the window because I was afraid you weren't going to go for a high enough assessment. So I am happy that it's moving in that direction. And I wanted to say that we're all here to fight for you, to stand behind you, and we're trying to educate people in town and spread the word. But we need all of you to stand up and advocate and be bold and be decisive and set a high assessment. And we will stand behind you. We will do our part, but we need you guys to do that. And the other point I wanted to make, kind of in conjunction with what you just said, all those numbers where we're below the average, nobody wants to get into an us versus them situation, but for other departments in town, they are getting a higher percentage than the state average, and where we get lower on every single one of those numbers that you just gave out, that's not fair. I think it was Bob that said it. We can't just take what's handed to us and do the best. It's not fair anymore. The inequality is just unacceptable. And if we want our kids to be happy, healthy, and available in the classroom, like you keep saying, we need to support them. We need to provide for them. And we'll do our part if you guys do your part too. So I hope you will.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Would anybody else like to be heard? Because I have a motion on the floor in a second.
Is it okay if I don't give my name?
No.
I have to give my name. My name is Jim Hickey, and I live on Perry Ave.
Thank you.
And I'm actually embarrassed that I've lived in Hanson for 26 years. And this is the first school committee meeting I've ever gone to. Now, I'm going to ask Tracy not to put my name in the paper because I do have ulterior motives. I'm running for selectman in May, and that's not why I stood up here in front of everyone. I think you have to, and I guess I'm talking to the board, and I'm not going to pretend I know what's going on, but I think you do have to go for the 11.5% as a board and let the townspeople choose. I can't remember that gentleman's name sitting right there, but he's the principal of the Whitman Middle School.
George Farrow.
George, it was nice to listen to you. And I wanted to comment on what he said. Because if you don't go for the 11.5%, that, or if you do, that's only going to get 60 kids a chance to learn Spanish. So if you go lower, those 60 kids aren't going to get that chance. I don't know, you know, with all these percentages, and I'm not going to pretend to know, I didn't go to college. But my four children did. And they went through this school system. And I have a daughter who's a civil engineer down in New Orleans. I have a son that's a sound designer in Washington, D.C. My daughter is going to, she had an interview today at MIT. She's going to be a research scientist. And she came from Hanson. But yet, Hanson is worried about Hanson 200, which is in the year 2020, and they're trying to fund that and getting donations. I'm obviously not the smartest person in the room. I could be the dumbest. But to me, education is the most important. And I think as a committee, whether the town accepts it or not, you have to vote the 11.5%. And like I said, I wouldn't understand 11.5%, but George told me if 11.5% does not get accepted, 60 kids will not be able to learn Spanish, and that bothers me. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hickman.
Chris George, 4 Shelley Lane. Thank you for saying that. I think it's a shame that either town, given the state of education, would look to celebrate anything that has to do with town pride at this point, because we should be ashamed of where we are. When I moved here 14, 15 years ago, I grew up in Rockland. I went to a private liberal arts college, a good school. I had a good, solid public education in a town that, you know, was behind other towns in the area. When I was in high school, I looked up to Whitman-Hanson. I looked up to some of the surrounding towns. I can't say that anymore. I can say I may have made a mistake in moving out of my hometown. That is a town that has funded education. This is a town that hasn't. We've funded some buildings. That's great. We have great teachers. I'm very involved in our elementary school. I love the school my children go to. I look at Mr. Farrow, I'm sure he does a great job. My daughter goes there next year. I don't know if I can keep her there past next year. I have to look at other options. I can't, in good conscience, not give her the opportunities that I had. I think people really need to take a hard look at what they want their town to be. I think that people do need some information, even at 11.5%, we're in trouble. If anything less than that gets voted, maybe people aren't going to a high school basketball game next year. Maybe people aren't going to an arts festival. I think we need to keep academic teachers in the classroom at any cost. And I think it's time that we put that out there. I think the townspeople need to realize that you can't, despite the amount of fundraising our athletic programs do, you can't have an athletic program if you've got 32 kids in a classroom, or whatever that number is going to be when we look at cutting 20 or 30 teachers. You just can't. Everything else has to go. And I do think we need to put those numbers out there. I think we need to make some hard, or you need to make some hard decisions about what that's going to mean if we only get 3% or 5%. Kevin, I get what you're saying about the transportation money, but even if Hanson took all of that $90,000 and gave it to the schools, you're only going to get 111 from Whitman, because it's got to be at that 60-40 ratio, or 120 whatever thousand it's going to be. Well, it's the assessment, right? It's the assessment. So $90,000 to Hanson is 125 to Whitman.
Well, the non-mandated, the they pay.
They'll have that money available to them, but you still, so Hanson's looking at an override anyway. If Whitman can give you that entire 400,000, no. Where does Hanson get the other 250 that it's got to come up with? So, because it's not part of your operating budget today. So to get it into the operating budget, it's got to be at a 60-40 ratio, right? So.
I think they pay for the non-mandated themselves. Well,
they do. Just so if Whitman's got $400,000 available to them, Hanson's got 90. You only ask Whitman for 125.
That's an independent decision. One town could decide to do.
The non-mandated assessment is a totally separate assessment. But
if they did away with that, you're right, Whitman would have the additional $350,000.
In the levy.
In the levy, right.
But Hanson's only going to have 90.
And Hanson's going to have 90. So if they voted not to do that, if we increase the assessment, it's still going to be 60-40.
Right. So you're not going to get all of that money from Whitman unless Hanson goes for an override. So either way, you're in an override situation. It doesn't equate to...
It's just
think we are no matter what.
Yeah.
Well, I agree. A reason why we shouldn't be... If they decide to do that, as you know, Whitman says, I can go for less of an override because I'm not going to offer busing, great. But we shouldn't be taking that into account when we look at the assessment.
No, it was just a factor in figuring out the funding is all. And you also have the population shift. So the number's not always going to be the same. Some of our costs are funded, you know, by the agreement, but some of them are just borne by the towns as part of providing schooling. And so when Hanson's proportional population goes down, that first 150,000 or so, well, Whitman's paying for Hanson's 150 off the bat. So when you look at gaps like that, and you start saying, well, if we assess at a certain number, it's 1% to Hanson and 6% to Whitman, for instance. That's a gap, and I'm saying that's one way to close that gap.
I agree, it's a potential way.
So regardless, though, it does sound like this is going to be a big number, so I don't think that you're not going to be able to patch it over. If you're talking about 11%, then we're past that. Anyway.
But I agree with you that by, you know, very shortly, even at 11.5%, people need to understand what those cuts are going to be if the percentages aren't reached. And I know we might not know everything, but I do think it's time to say, hey, this whole program goes, this whole program goes, this whole program goes, and then the rest gets made up with whatever number of teachers or whatever that is. But I do think people need to hear those hard facts. You know, we fought hard last year. The turnout was pretty dismal. I think in both towns, really. I think when you look at the voter rolls, the turnout of parents of older children was pretty dismal. And hopefully, you know, if there is more at stake, those folks will show up. So.
Kevin?
Just make a quick statement. Sure, Kevin.
Hi, Kevin Kafka. Certainly from the association's perspective, we will do anything that we can to support the committee, mobilize behind, and obviously bring this out into the public. I like to be involved in discussions and activities moving forward about the how-to, whether it's for, you know, information, assembly, something on the outside. I'd love to meet with the committee and you know, be able to discuss that moving forward. So just wanted to throw that out there. Thanks.
Thank you.
Just to give you an idea, if you break the numbers down, if you took a 3% assessment, I'm just, because that was mentioned earlier, 3%, and you took the differences, and say the town of Whitman and Hanson said 3% is all we can afford before we go to an override situation. Whitman's override would be $1.4 million. Hanson's override would be about $640,000. That would be the differences in the two costs to come up with the 11.5%. If you go to the budget book, it's pretty easy numbers to do. Subtract one from the other and you're coming up with general numbers, cutting it off, just rounding it out. So that's what it would be. If you figure every 1%, for anybody that wants to do the math at home that might be watching this evening, or in the gallery, every 1% equates to approximately $186,000. So if you go off of that and you're adding, if you don't have the chart that we have, and you're advocating one way or the other for 3 or 4 or 5, just figure out every point, every 1% is $186,718. It's pretty simple to figure out what 5, 4, 3, or any of that would be. So it's important if somebody wants to look and say, how do we come up with whatever the differences are here? Figure your percentage points at 186,718.
And I think it's important to remind people that does not mean that the operating budget is up by 11 or 11.5%. The operating budget is up by about 3%, is that?
Yeah, it's close to 4 now with the increase in the insurance.
Okay.
And I do want to let everyone know that this chart is actually on our website. If you go to the www.whrsd.org. Under the budget tab, this whole budget book presentation is right there. So on page 37, that chart is there.
Okay. Anyone further? Because I have a motion and a second on the floor. Okay. The motion was to set the assessment at 11.5%, which equates to $2,147,260, broken down to the town of Whitman at $1,278,693, in the town of Hanson, $868,567. That is what the motion is. Am I correct, Mr. Small?
Yes. Total assessment for Hanson,
868,567.
Yep. That's the increase.
Nope.
Yes.
That's the increase.
That's the total increase in the assessment. Just take the 11.5 and go straight across.
Okay. Yep. That sounds correct.
It's total one skip.
Was that your motion?
That is my motion.
That's a total.
Yeah, but
the total increase on the current level assessments.
Right. Yeah. So Hanson's actually $8,421,319.
That is correct.
Okay. I'm talking about the increase from.
Yeah, the increase. Correct. Yeah, that is my motion.
Is there any further?
Assessment figure. He's talking about.
Yes. Okay. The assessment increase.
Right. We're talking about the increase. Right. Is there any confusion to that? Does everyone understand?
Yes.
That is the motion on the table. All those in favor?
It does require a two-thirds vote.
Yes. Okay. All those in favor, Mr. Small's motion?
Sure.
I believe it's unanimous. Thank you. Okay. New business. We had negotiated and voted the superintendent's contract in executive session. It needs to be brought out and voted in open session. I would entertain a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Bob, did we get copies of that?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was my question.
I don't have any copies.
We did this last year, right?
Yes.
You approved it in executive session last year.
Yeah. Some of us weren't on at that point.
All right, I wasn't there.
Yeah.
Sure. You guys weren't on?
Correct.
So you can stay.
Why are we, when was this vote actually taken?
The vote was done in December of 2015. It should have gone to open meeting, and it inadvertently was left off the agenda.
We weren't on, okay.
Okay, let's revote that. I'd entertain a motion to accept.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Abstaining? Okay. Field trips. I don't believe I have any field trips.
No, we don't.
Just donations.
All we have is
donations.
The gift.
Indian Head Memo.
Yes. Dear Dr. Whitner, I am requesting the acceptance of $2,000 from General Dynamics Mission Systems to the Indian Head School for their up-and-coming STEAM event. This money will be used to purchase small robots to help teach coding to elementary school students. The robots will be used primarily by fifth-grade students who will be housed in the library. Thank you for your consideration of this request. Sincerely, Elaine White. I entertain a motion to accept.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
Mm-hmm.
Fred?
And also, just if I could point out on the back that it was requested by an employee of General Dynamics, Amy Johnson, from their Taunton facility. And I'd just like to personally thank Amy for requesting that for us.
Okay. Thank you. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you. Why are gifts always so easy to do?
Because there's no ties.
Subcommittee reports. We have one subcommittee report, if there is anything to report, legislative update.
Tomorrow is the first Ways and Means meeting. Josh Cutler, our Josh Cutler, is now on that committee. Josh did mention March 29th, there's an educational hearing at UMass Boston. This covers DESE and our local aid, so if anyone's interested.
Okay, just an FYI.
March 29th?
Yes. What?
Yeah.
Yeah, 29th.
Independence Academy has invited us to a legislative breakfast on Friday, March 10th, on Belmont Street in Brockton. Anyone that wants to go, please contact Michelle Kelly, because I believe we have to respond.
Yeah, Mr. Morgan called, and he was just wondering if anybody was attending.
Another date to remember is a week from today, we will be having the final budget meeting to discuss any changes that may come from the budget. That's next Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. It will be a school committee member. It will be a school committee meeting for members. We will be discussing the budget again and whatever else happens to come up on the agenda. Also on the 15th, there is a facility subcommittee at 6 p.m. here in the library.
It's going to be at 5:45. We have a pretty heavy agenda with the warrant articles, so we'd like folks to come 15 minutes early.
There'll be a lot of
warrants. Okay, so that'll be at 5:45.
If we could have those in our packets, that would be...
She's working on them, yep.
Fantastic.
An entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you, everyone, for coming this evening.